This is the Schrodinger equation. I know it looks ugly, but don't run away. I'm going to talk about what the Schrodinger equation actually means, and hopefully you'll see it doesn't deserve its bad reputation. See, physics tries to predict the future. What I mean is, if you have an object in some state that you know, and then you do something to it, you let it go above the ground, or you give it a big push, or you put it next to something electric, the job of physics is to tell you what happens to the object next. Newtonian mechanics did a good job of that. If you know the initial position and velocity of an object, it will tell you exactly where the particle is at any time in the future. In other words, you give it the initial state of the object, and based on the surroundings, it will give you the final state at time t. What we want for quantum mechanics is something that will do the same. Tell us what the future state of the system is. And that's what the Schrodinger equation is for. In fact, there is a much nicer way to write this equation that puts it exactly into this form. Remember, the state of a quantum particle is given by the wave function. So if this is the wave function at the start, the Schrodinger equation tells you that this thing acts on it to produce the wave function t seconds into the future. Then the question is, what is this transformation and why is it that way? If you're interested in the history of quantum mechanics, then you may have heard Schrodinger essentially came down from the mountains with his fully formed equation with no derivation. This is kind of true, but that doesn't mean that there's no way to motivate the Schrodinger equation these days. The main thing it comes down to is actually conservation of energy. It's surprisingly straightforward, but I decided to put the derivation of the equation into the next video. See, the derivation of the equation and how to precisely use it are good to know, but are kind of optional in terms of what we'll do later. However, there is one fact about the equation that is so vital we will use it again and again in future videos. That one fact is so important that it's all we need to understand quantum computers and to prove the no cloning theorem and quantum teleportation and discuss the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics, plus basically everything else we're going to do. So here it is. Time evolution is linear. Let me explain that. Suppose I have an object and there are two different states I can start the object in. For example, I could just drop this object so it has no velocity to begin, or I could throw it so it has a big starting velocity. We know what would happen to the object in each of those cases, right? We apply time evolution to each, and this is how they evolve. But now, suppose my object didn't start in one of these two states, but actually a superposition of both. In this case, it both had no velocity and a big velocity to start. So, what happens to it over time? What do you expect happens? Think about it. Hopefully, what you expect is that it will be a superposition of the evolution of each of the states, so at each point in time, the state looks like this. The mathematical way to put this is the time evolution of a superposition is the linear combination of the time evolution of each of the states. This is what I mean. If you have a state in a superposition like this, to get the overall future state, you just look at the future state of the individual parts and then add them back up. It even holds if you write up that same state in a different basis. For example, if I change to the momentum basis here, the same rule applies, and so then these two states are equal to each other. They're both the future state. So the general statement of linearity is this. And this does seem like a reasonable thing to request from quantum mechanics, but linearity has some subtle philosophical statements about superposition hidden in it. Look back at this example. It says that these separate parts of the superposition don't act like they know the other part is there. This part of the object here doesn't look over its shoulder and see that there's another part of the superposition and then decide to do something else. Regardless of whether there is another state in the superposition or not, this part of the superposition does the same thing. In other words, anything in this part of the superposition evolves completely unaware of the other parts. Well, that is until measurement happens. When you measure, the branches of the superposition have the chance to interact with each other again. That's because measurement doesn't follow the Schrodinger equation. This fact, that measurement doesn't obey the same rule that everything else in the universe is subject to, is so bizarre, if not downright contradictory, that it has its own name, the measurement problem, and it's the biggest foundational issue in quantum mechanics. Meanwhile, everything else evolves perfectly linearly in time, unaware of the other branches of the superposition. If you want to know where linearity comes from and what might have inspired the Schrodinger equation in the first place, click this link to the next video.